Good morning, everybody. My name is Francesco Russo, and I'm going to talk to you about Java Test Runner, which is a framework and a project for writing and running tests in Java. Well, the first things we have to focus on is the importance of testing. Testing is really important just because anyone who has just been a human being is prone to failure, and also the most experienced developer generally makes failure during their lifetime. But another important thing to recognize is that when we talk about correctness of software, we are not just talking about some kind of adherence to some specification, behavioral specification, but it is also important to keep in mind that correctness is also about meeting performance requirements. But since the testing problem is a thought one, it is absolutely fundamental approaching the problem from different perspectives. Just because behaving this way, we can apply different testing methodologies. Each one of them is particularly useful for tackling the problem specific for a subject area. For example, we might start talking about behavioral unit testing. This kind of testing is generally particularly useful when we need to simply find out if behavioral requirements are met or not by software components, and this kind of testing is generally adopted to prove correctness of small atomic software pieces. Behavioral testing is generally followed by integration testing. Applying this testing technique, we just put together multiple small software components to give life to subsystems and to test how these components do interact with one another. And after integration testing, we come to system and stress testing, which is particularly interesting just because stress testing is a destructive attitude which is not found in other testing methodology and is useful for trying and find out to which extent we think we can take our system just because it goes down. Also important is user acceptor testing, useful for measuring the end user satisfaction when using the whole system. But this brief and far from being complete classification is just useful to us for positioning the JTR project, defining it as a dynamic testing tool which is suitable for both integration system testing and behavioral unit testing. So let's now try and understand how we can use the features delivered by the JTR project to make it easy testing software. Well, the first thing we can do is obviously testing standard Java classes, by which I mean plain old Java objects, the traditional Peugeots. Things like this can be also accomplished by means of other testing tools, for example, just to mention one, JUnit. But it is also possible using some features really useful for testing stateful and stateless session beans, both adhering to the J2EE 1.4 specification and file specification. All the tricks that are necessary for distinguishing about the two specification are all disguised by the JTR runtime framework to the test developer, so it is really easy. JTR comes really handy when we are about testing web services too, just because leveraging on the powerful JAX-WS runtime, it is also possible to test web services without having client stubs for these web services, just because the JTR runtime is able to dynamically generate client stubs on our behalf. And so we just have to prepare the request and test the web service. The same facilities are also allowed for JMS applications. In this sense, the JTR runtime is also able to handle on our behalf things like topic, queues management, connection, and so on. So the main objective of the JTR framework and runtime is generally trying to make it as easy as possible for the test developer to focus and concentrate on what is his main subject, that is writing tests. When talking about tests, parameters do play an important role, just because everyone of us knows that simply changing some input parameters to our functions or algorithm behavior can change, and also providing some special parameters, we can face corner cases that might lead to bugs. And as far as parameters are concerned, GTR adopts an inversion of control-based runtime systems, by which I mean that your test classes are deployed into a runtime systems that takes care of providing your test class with resources, parameters, and so on. So push is preferred over pull. Parameterization can be happen with fixed values, by which I mean that we can assign constant values to our test input parameters, values that do not change over time during test execution, but it is also generally useful binding input test parameters to statistical functions, just because we know that at runtime the system will be asked to answer with values that generally mimic some well-known statistical function. And the GTR framework comes with a bunch of statistical functions already built in, but you can also easily extend it. Well, if neither fixed values nor statistically generated ones are enough for you, you can also bind to your test input parameters scripts that you write. You can write scripts both in Bean Shell scripting language or in the Groovy scripting language, but it is also really easy plugging in your favorite scripting engine in just a matter of classes, of a couple of classes. So let's now dive into a really simple example. Generally, writing a test in the GTR terminology is translated into writing a runner. A typical runner, which is the first DEM runner in this example, has to inherit from some framework-provided abstract class just to inherit some useful behavior. And we start coding our testing logic overriding the test method. The test method can throw any kind of exception, as we can see in this example, and this means that the GTR runtime will take care of catching all those exceptions and provide the end user with some useful diagnostic message. It is also possible checking for correctness during text execution, leveraging the JUnit assertion API, which is really powerful. We can also provide the end user with proper messages for later inspection. Another interesting thing is that our test input parameters do not require to be shielded by any mutator method, just because the runtime framework is able to inject values and resources without any mutator method. And this is how we can instruct the GTR runtime on the way our test should be executed. This is accomplished by means of the GTR configuration file, which is a simple XML configuration file, and this is just a simple snippet. And we can say things just like how many times the test has to be run, which test class should be run, how many instances have to be created and launched, and these allows us achieving declarative concurrent test execution. And we can also bind the test input parameters to values. In this example, we are binding a fixed input value, a statistically generated one, using one of the built-in functions. We are also tying a parameter to a script we have provided here using the Bean Shell scripting language. So let's now try and run the former example. And what we see upon test completion is the GTR console. The GTR console shows on the left side of the window the nodes over which the test has been run, which test classes have been executed, and for each test class, how many instances have been created and executed. And for each instance, on the right side of the window, there is a detailed message for each time the test has been executed with some useful information, for example, the time that the test execution has required, the outcome status of the execution, and the custom message with which you can provide diagnostic information to the end user. So we have talked about writing a simple test, but as we have already seen, we can run it many times with declarative concurrent test execution and also anywhere. Declarative distributed test execution means that we actually can distribute our test to a cluster of passive nodes. By simply adding this snippet of XML code to the configuration file, with which we are stating that we want the test to be distributed to the set of nodes, Freddy, Barney, and Davis, for example. Just a couple of definitions might be useful here. JTR ActiveNode is a node that obviously runs the JTR runtime, but has also knowledge of all the test classes, by which I mean the runners we have written, and all their third-party libraries they might require. While a passive node is deeply different just because it simply runs the JTR runtime in passive mode and has no knowledge of any other resource, classes we have written, or libraries they might require at runtime. So distributed testing works as follows. The first step is for the active node sending the configuration to the configure set of passive node. Once a passive node starts executing the test, eventually, it will meet a missing class or resource event just because, as we have already seen, passive nodes do not have locally classes or resources required for test execution. Thus, a passive node issues a missing class or resource request to the active node, which provides, by a network class loading mechanism, all those classes or resources to the passive nodes. So let's run it again. And the result is that now, in the JTR console, on the left side, we not only see the local host, that is, the active node from which we have started the test, but also all the set, in this case, three passive nodes that have been contacted and involved in the test execution. And for each passive node, we can see that five instances of the first runner have been created and executed 20 times, just like it was specified in the configuration file. So what we have learned is that no manual deployment of test resources by classes or parameterization information or anything like that is required of a passive node. We can just control one single node, the active one, and then the test is automatically distributed over the network of configured nodes. Firewalls obviously are not a problem as long as we keep all the required ports open. There are two ports that should be kept open on the active node and on the passive nodes, and they are completely configurable. And what about JUnit? Well, JUnit is surely one of the most used unit testing framework around, and it is really useful because it is so easy and powerful at the same time. That's why JTR file, which is in beta 2 now, smoothly integrates JUnit 4 tests. This is important just because any one of us has or should have a bunch of JUnit test cases to prove one's software correctness. And now it is also possible running JUnit 4 tests seamlessly along with JTR 5 native tests. There is much more to talk about, for example, anti-integration, headless testing, basic reporting, and much more details about web services testing or JMS testing. But time is over, or it is going to be. We have 2 minutes left. So I just have to say thank you all for being here and for paying attention to my speech. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah?
You know, projects using
I don't know if I can say anything, but for example, I've had some requests, some mail contacts with Project Neuromancer, which is a project that is run by some microsystem. Another couple of software companies based in Sweden, if I'm not wrong, then it has been checked out by the EBI, the European Bioinformatics Institute in Cambridge, but I don't know exactly what they are doing with it. Yeah?
The license?
It's GPL.
60 GPL.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. In fact, talking with other communities, for example, the one on java.net. They have been asking me to modify the licensing. It's a point we are thinking about now. Maybe with the release file of the JTR framework, there will be some changes. But for now, I'm not really scared about this issue. You're welcome. OK.
Could you,
in the 5 minutes back.